So, in the last class, we had talked in detail about how to develop complex models, and what we will be doing today in the this specific class is essentially a follow-up on that, and we'll be actually talking more about specifics, constructing actual models, and also solving those. So, in one of the earlier classes, we had developed a lumped mass model, lumped parameter model for a suspension system for a car. So, we will revisit that because we never solved it in that class. So, to recap, let us say you have a mass, this could be the mass of the car, and since the car has four wheels, I will only take one fourth of the structure. So, I will only consider one wheel and the load shared by it. So, the mass of the car, or the 1/4 mass of the car, is MMC, and this is my wheel which is moving on a road which could be uneven. So, as this wheel moves on the road, it moves up and down, and what I am interested in this particular problem is, as the wheel moves up and down, the person sitting on this body, what kind of motion does he or she experience? That is what I am interested in. So, what I am interested is that if the velocity here is u road, what is the velocity of the person? So, I can call it u car. Now, between the car body and the wheel, typically we have springs. I will put a compliance member. And also we have sometimes dashpots which damp the vibrations. I am calling this as CMS, S meaning suspension. So, it is compliance of the suspension, it is mechanical compliance of suspension. And this is RMS, that is mechanical resistance of the suspensions. Now, the wheel itself has mass, as it moves up and down, it has some mass. So, I assign it a value, moving mass of wheel, which is W. And there is air inside the wheel, which acts as a stiffness member. So, it also has a stiffness CMW. So, again, what I am interested is if there is an input motion because of the unevenness of the road, which is u road, then what is the motion which is going to be experienced by the person sitting inside the car? That is what I am interested. So, let us construct a lumped parameter model of this, and I am going to use the mobility equivalence to construct it. So, that is my input source, u road. And I have two masses, and in mobility equivalence, we always ground the mass. So, my first mass is this, it is MMW, and this is my second mass, which is mass of the car, or 1/4 of the car mass. So, it is MMC, and I am going to ground both of these. Also, I have this stiffness or compliance element, CMW, and then I have suspension stiffness and suspension damping. Both are in parallel. So, I put them in parallel. So, here it is 1 over RMS and this CMS. Let us put some numbers on these terms. So, CMS is 4 times 10 to the power of minus 6 meters per Newton. MMW, which is the mass of the wheel, around 30 kilograms. 1 over RMS is 7 times 10 to the power of minus 4 meter per Newton second. Compliance of the suspension stiffness is 1.7 times 10 to the power of minus 5 meters per Newton. And mass of the car, or 1/4 of its mass, let's say it is 455 kilograms.
Sir?
Yeah?
We have done this example.
Huh?
We have done this example.
Yes. We have done only part of the example. We never solved it. We did only the breakpoints. So, we will very quickly revisit those breakpoints and then actually start solving it. So, the first breakpoint, so what we are interested in is this ratio, U car over U road. This is my transfer function. That's what I'm interested in. How does this ratio change as my excitation frequencies change? Now, we had in the earlier class talked about breakpoints. The first breakpoint is associated with the fact that for some set of frequencies, current will be more or less passing through the resistance, and as frequencies go up in number, then that the current going through the inductor will become less and less, and most of the current will go through through the resistor. I have incorrectly labeled it. This is 1 over RMS and this is CMS. Okay. The other breakpoint is associated with this loop versus current going through the other loop. Very quickly, we call this loop 1, we call this loop 2, and also we assign another variable here, which is the voltage difference across these two points, and we call it U wheel. Remember, velocity of the wheel, which is essentially velocity of this point, is not necessarily identical to the velocity here. So, we consider loop 2, and in loop 2, I have this parallel circuit. This is 1 over RMS, CMS. So, as we talked earlier, at low frequencies, most of the current will go through the inductor. As frequencies go up, current will start going, less current will flow through the inductor, and more and more of it will go through the resistance. So, the crossover point will be such that 1 over RMS equals 2 pi F times CMS. So, this gives me the first breakpoint F1 is 1 over RMS times CMS, and that is 6.6 hertz. So, again, below 6.6 hertz, more current will go through the inductor. Above 6.6 hertz, more current will go through the resistor. So, this is first breakpoint. Second breakpoint is associated with the fact, so above 6.6 hertz, the current going through this circuit will also have some sort of resonance. This is MMC. So, let's compute the breakpoint of MMC and the compliance, and let's see where it falls. So, for this circuit, which is essentially as current is going through this route, let's see if the resonance is below 6.6 hertz or not. For this one, my frequency is F2 is 1 over 2 pi 1 over MMC times CMS, and when I plug in the numbers, I get 1.81 hertz. So the point what I am trying to make is that below 6.6 hertz, most of the current in this circuit will flow through the inductor, and within that range from 0 to 6.6, there it will cross a certain breakpoint again, which corresponds to 1.8 hertz. If this number had been more than 6.6 hertz, then this analysis would have been meaningless, because current would haven't gone through this, wouldn't have gone through CMS anyway. For third breakpoint, what we are interested in knowing is what happens when current goes through CMW and MMW. That's another inflection point. So for that one, F3 equals 1 over 2 pi CMW times MMW, and that gives me 14.5 hertz. Okay. So these are my three frequencies: 1.8 hertz, 6.6 hertz, 14.5 hertz. So I have to find in from 0 to 1.6 how is the circuit behaving, from 1.8 to 6.6 how is the circuit behaving, and from 6.6 to 14.5 how is it behaving, and what happens above 14.5. So that is what we will do today, and our aim is to find this transfer function. Yeah.
Why are we interested in taking CMW and MMW? We should have considered, because current has to pass through CMW, so we should have considered the MMW branch or the rest of the branch. So instead of considering CMW and resonance between CMW and MMW, we should have considered between MMW and rest of the branch.
So we will see that how it becomes. Just hold on. So you will see that.
CMW
will be in the circuit regardless.
Yes, sir. Right. So we have to consider this and this branch.
Yes. So just hold on to your thought. So you will see the relevance. So what we are interested in is this ratio. So U car over U road equals U car over U wheel times U wheel over U road. So what we will do is, in general, our approach will be, we will find how this transfer function is changing with respect to frequency, and how this transfer function is changing with respect to frequency. We will construct board plots for both of these two transfer functions, and then we will add them up, and then we will get the total transfer. And in this context, the value, you will see the importance of 14 points. Okay, we will see later in detail. So what we will start with is U car over U wheel, this ratio. So again, U car, so to make it clear, this is my U car. So U car over U wheel, in that context, what we are interested in is essentially loop 2. Whatever happens on loop 1 does not have a bearing on how the ratio U wheel over U car or U car over U wheel will get impacted. Now, the reason why we are doing all this is that if you don't have a computer and you don't have to solve very complicated equations, then you can get reasonably good board plots using this approach. You break the circuit in small pieces and analyze them piece by piece. Given that we have a lot of computers, we have software tools which you can make all these circuits and the software tools, and the software will solve for complex quantities very quickly. But to get a physical insight as to what is happening, that's why we are doing. So to get my U car over U wheel, this is my sub assembly, and what I have is MMC. This is C suspension stiffness, and that's my damping ton. So switching screens. So this is my UR and that's my U wheel. So let's see what happens above A if my frequency exceeds 6.6 hertz. If my frequency is above 6.6 hertz, if it is less than 6.6 hertz, then in this circuit, I can ignore the impact of CMS. So all I have is 1 over RMS and MMC. So then my distilled down circuit becomes one over RMS and MMC.
Distance should be ignored. Less than 6.6.
CMS. Yep, this is U wheel and that's my U car. The through variable going through it is force. So the current, which is analogous, will be something like U wheel times divided by the impedance of this entire circuit, Z, which is U wheel over, I'll write the impedance here, 1 over S, which is my complex frequency, J omega, times CMS plus 1 over S MMC. So I get that as U wheel over S square CMS MMC plus 1 into S MMC. And my voltage difference across the moving mass of the car is basically this current times MMC times S, the impedance offered by 1 over whatever that number. So U car is this whole term, U wheel over the whole denominator times S MMC to 1 over S MMC. So my U car over U wheel equals 1 over 1 minus, and once I put S equals J omega, I get omega square CMS MMC. So this is for frequencies less than 6.6. So now I make a plot of it. I'll construct a Bode plot, and a Bode plot has two parts, low frequency asymptote and high frequency asymptote. When the frequency goes low, then this value becomes 1. So my 20 log of this value becomes 0. When this frequency becomes very high, I get a negative slope of how many dBs? 40 dBs, because there is an omega square. If it was just omega times some number, it would have been a 20 decibel negative slope, but I will get a minus 40 dB slope. And the threshold, the crossover point, so my Bode plot will look like, actually I will plot it here itself. So this is my decibels, log omega, my frequency response will look like something like this, and the slope is minus 40 dB per decade. My actual curve, because at a particular value of when this denominator becomes zero, my actual value will look something like this. Because there's resonance happening. But what we'll be constructing is essentially the dark line, which is the asymptotic curve. B. When frequency exceeds 6.6 hertz, what will happen? I can drop the compliance term and include the resistive term. So my equivalent circuit will be this will be my equivalent circuit. Can you infer what will be the shape of the board plot for this one, for this circuit, without going through the analysis? I mean, we can construct, you know, we can develop again as we did here, find the overall impedance and find the voltage difference across the moving mass. But just based on whatever we did here, if I have an inductor and a capacitor in series, I get a minus 40 dB slope. If I have a resistor and a capacitor in series, what kind of a slope will I get?
Plus 20.
20. Minus 20 or plus 20?
Plus 20, yes.
So the slope across, if it was purely a resistor, what will be the slope across it?
Yeah.
It will be 0.
0.
Right. Because there is no omega term in it. If there was no capacitor or inductor, the slope of the response curve will be 0 because there is no omega term. You have omega square, so that generates a 40 dB. So it will be only 20 dB. Also, what is this number? What is this frequency?
1 over CMS MMC.
And what is that number? Is it 6.6? We calculated three frequencies, right?
2 pi into 1.81.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We calculated three frequencies. One was, where is it? 6.6 hertz, 1.8 and 14.5. Which one is this?
2 pi into 1.8.
1.8. Yeah, I am just calling frequency. Yes. If you want to make it omega, it will be 2 pi. So it's 1.8 hertz. So this is 1.8 hertz. So it keeps on going with a negative slope of minus 40 dBs. Above 6.6 hertz, as you guys mentioned, so I'll construct this again. Log omega. This is decibels, this is 0 dB, 1.8 hertz, I have a slope of minus 40 dB up to 6.6 hertz, and above 6.6 hertz I get minus 20 dB slope. Here the slope is minus 40 dB. I am plotting a resistor and a capacitor in series, yes.
It should be constant after a while, because it would be 1 upon SC plus R.
What I am plotting is a ratio of the voltage difference across this element and the input, which is U wheel, right? So there will be an omega dependency always, because U car is dependent on omega. So this is my overall plot up to 6.6 hertz. Now what we will do is, so we have plotted this one, U car over U wheel. Now we will work on U wheel over U road. So U wheel over U road, and the effective circuit for that is essentially this. So this is U road, that is mass of the car, mass of the wheel, CMW, MMW, and this is compliance of wheel. What will the board plot for this circuit look like?
-40 dB.
Right. High frequency or low frequency?
High frequency.
And low frequency?
0.
It will be a 0 dB. Same thing which we did earlier. Right. What will be this number?
14.5
hertz. This is my decibel scale. I'm plotting log of omega on this one. This is 0 dB. Slope is -40 dB/dB. The actual curve may look something like this, because at resonance the denominator goes to 0. So this is U wheel over U road. So I have a plot for U wheel over U road, and I have a plot for U car over U wheel. So all I have to do is now just add these two up. So my final plot looks something like this. I have three breakpoints, 1.8, 6.6, 14.5. I have initially a flat line at 0 dB. Then I get a negative slope of -40 Hz, -40 dB. Then my slope is still negative, but it reduces. This is -40 dB/dB. This is -20 dB/dB. And then I get a very acute -60 dB/dB. So what this picture is showing is that given the parameters which we had listed earlier in the mechanical circuit, first thing is that you have virtually no attenuation at very low frequency. It's all 0 dB. Whatever is going in is being experienced by the passenger. And as frequencies go up, you start seeing attenuation, and that attenuation starts very rapidly increasing after this 14.5 Hz. That's what you see. So you have to pick the right amount of damping, the right amount of stiffness as you are designing. Whether it's a mechanical, it's a suspension circuit or an acoustic system, what this is telling you is that you have to make the proper choices of some of these parameters so that you get the right amount of damping. It also tells you is that if the frequency of input signals, which is essentially coming from the road, is in this region, let's say your road is such that most of the frequencies are coming from 0 to 1.8 Hz, then the suspension is doing not much. Right? So depending on the road conditions, you have to construct, you have to develop or identify the right parameters of your suspension stiffness and suspension damping numbers. That's what you say. So whatever, you have to understand the topography, and based on that you construct the right damping. Another thing you should think about is that, and this will help you understand this, that suppose you are driving, suppose this road, this is perfectly flat road, but in real conditions it is doing this, right, and your car is going like this. The car is seeing the same amount of vibrations, whether it is going at slow speeds or at high speed. But the driver experience changes. You can try it, even on a scooter or a bike, you could try it. You have a small bump when you hit, and you go across, try to cross it at a high speed, or try to cross it at a slow speed, and how do you feel? And why do you feel? You should think about it and figure out, based on this understanding, at different speeds, even though the amount of bumps and the frequency of bumps is same, the perception of the person who is driving the car or bike or motorcycle changes, and the amount of vibrations he or she experiences also changes. And it also depends on speed. And what that has to do is, it relates to the Doppler effect, that as you are moving at higher speeds, right, the apparent frequency of these bumps which are coming from the road, it goes high or low? The frequency,
high.
It goes high. So that has a bearing, and that you can relate that fact to this curve and figure out why you feel, will you feel better at higher frequencies or at higher speeds, or you will feel more uncomfortable at higher speeds. You have to think about it. So we have done one example, and this one was overdue. We had constructed this. The next example we will today do is of a loudspeaker. Given that this is an acoustics course, what we will talk in the remaining part of the lecture is model of the speaker, and we'll also try to, if hopefully we'll try to finish this solving it today itself, at least one model of the speaker. So what you are seeing here is a magnet which is sandwiched between two metal plates. Okay. The plate on this side is called the rear plate or the back plate, and the plate on the front side is called, it's on the front, so it's called front plate, because this is the front of the speaker, so it's on the front side, so it's called front plate. And between the front plate and the center, you have this magenta or pink metallic piece. This is also made of a regular steel which could be magnetized, and there is a small gap between this blue front plate and the pink pole piece, and in this gap you have this voice coil. So just to zoom in, you have front plate, you have pole piece, here you have voice coil on which the windings are there, and here this could be a magnet. I'm just cutting a cross section. And this is your back plate, and back plate is connected with the pull piece, something like this. So the way magnetic circuit works is, this is magnet, it acts like a battery. So you have magnetic flux lines going here, then they can also go in air, but air is much more resistive, so they don't go there, they get bent, they come here, they cut the voice coil conductor, they come here like that. This is how the circuit completes. So it's analogous to like an electrical circuit. This gap, people try to minimize this gap as little as possible, because the more gap you have, the impedance to the magnetic lines will be higher and higher. Typically, this gap between the voice coil and this is about half a millimeter, to account for tolerances and other things also. Also, you have gap on this side, so you have gap on front of the voice coil, and also this gap is there. This is gap 2. So people call it outside gap, inside gap. That is also not typically more than half a millimeter. If you have big gap, which it means that you have to put bigger magnet in this more stronger magnet and magnets are expensive. So people try to minimize the gap. So just wanted to give you some flavor of that. There's an electrical part, current is coming in. It goes through this voice coil winding. What will winding have in it? Electrically, what elements will it have in it? It's a conductor, so it will have resistance. Right? If you have to model it, you will model it as a resistor. And it also, it's a winding. So it can also be an inductor. So people model it as typically resistor and a inductor in series. That's the electrical side. Then the electrical side, the electrical energy gets converted to motion. So the transformation factor, that is what? DL. We saw it in the earlier class, right? And on the mechanical side, what do you have? This voice coil is moving up and down. It has some mass, right? So you can model it as a mass. Also, you are seeing that this green element, it's a suspension element. It acts as a
spring.
Similarly, this curve here, this also acts as a spring. So this is also, so these are two spring elements. So you have mass, because this voice coil is moving back and forth. It is physically moving back and forth, so it has a mass. There's an inertia effect. Also, this entire diaphragm is moving back and forth. That also has mass. So you have mass because of all these things. You have stiffness because of this spider and what they call the surround. Also, a spider itself has a little bit of mass. It's not much, but it has a mass which is not negligible. So people account for that mass also. So it has a mass. It has a spring element in it. And then also, anything, any mechanical thing moves, piece of paper, rubber, metal, does not, once you strike it, it vibrates for a while and then it damps down, because there is always internally damping in it. So people put damping elements also. So on the electrical side, there is resistor and inductor. On the mechanical side, there is, you have to think physically, how I am going to model it. There's literally, there's mass, there's spring, and there's damping. And then this whole speaker could be mounted in an infinite baffle or in a tube or whatever. So once we go to the acoustic side, what do we put? Radiation, impedance. Because that speaker is going to radiate energy out into free field, and that generates radiation impedance. So based on that physical understanding of the system, we'll construct lumped parameter system, model of a, we call it speaker. So my input energy is voltage. I can measure it, 14 volts, 10 volts, whatever. It goes through an, this is the electrical element, electrical side of the story. So I call it LE, electrical inductance, and this is RE, electrical resistance. Then electricity gets converted into motion. So what is my through variable here on the mechanical side? If I use impedance analogy, voltage corresponds to velocity. Right. U. And the through variable is?
Force.
Turn ratio is? BL is to 1. B is magnetic flux density. L is what?
Length
of what?
This conductor.
Which conductor?
This.
The total length of the wire. The total length of all these wires. It could be in several meters. There's a springiness in it that I represent by mechanical compliance, CM. there's mechanical mass mm and there's damping. Okay, I have a question here. Does it make sense to put CM, MM and RM in parallel, or should they be in series based on your physical understanding? This is the picture of the model. So should I put the mechanical elements, spring, mass and damping, in series or in parallel, or should I put them in whatever?
In parallel.
Why should I put
them? We are talking about the magnet here.
Magnet?
So, MM is the mass of
moving. MM is what they call mechanical mass.
Mechanical mass.
MM is the mechanical mass, which is a sum of this y square, it has some mass. Also part of this diaphragm which is moving back and forth.
All the element moves with same velocity.
Same
so
velocity.
We have to keep it in parallel.
So because we are using mobility model, u across each of these variables is same. And then this mechanical circuit is coupled with an acoustic circuit. And the turn ratio here is 1:AC. What is AC? It is area of the diaphragm.
Diaphragm area.
Right. Area of the cone. Whatever area is radiating sound, it is the area of that. What is the across variable here in the acoustic land? Volume velocity.
Volume velocity.
And the through variable here is?
Pressure.
Here I have current. And I am assuming that this speaker is mounted in an infinite baffle. What that means is that there is an infinite wall, extremely rigid. There is a small hole in it and there is a speaker mounted in it and it's firing sound on one side. On the other side there is vacuum. That is what I mean. So for that, from standard texts, the radiation impedance is, I have to put an acoustic mass here and then I have to put an acoustic resistor. Whatever is the energy dissipated across the acoustic resistor is something I will be listening to. So what we are interested in is VO, which is the voltage across this acoustic resistor. So given a value of V, what is the value of V naught? That is what I am interested in. So the transfer function which I am interested in is HS equals V naught over V. This is what I am trying to find. We will make this circuit a little simpler, not by dropping any element, because we have not done any element. What we will do is, we will eliminate this transformation here. And we had seen earlier, in an earlier class, that if I want to eliminate this transformation, my RA will get converted into RA divided by this turn ratio, square of turn ratio. So RA over AC square. My capacitor will get multiplied by that. And my voltage will get divided by, not square, but just by AC. So what we will do is, I'll just construct only this part of the circuit. So this is MA times AC square, this is RA over AC square, and my voltage will become V naught prime, which is basically V naught over AC. and this part of the circuit is same. So if I can find instead of V naught over V, if I can find V naught prime over V, I'm fine. I can very easily transform that into V naught. So now what I will do, I'll assign some values. So my B is magnetic field density is 1 Tesla. These are fairly close to some of the real numbers. If you go and buy a speaker, so what, and I've drawn this from Baranek book. It's about 10 inch big speaker. Length is 9 meters. So these are long wires. Just gives you an idea. There's a lot of copper coil wound in. RE is 8 ohms. And LE is 0.17 millihenries. Moving mass or mechanical mass is about 11 grams. Compliance is 1.79 times 10 to the power of minus 4 meters per Newton. RM is 0.5 Newton second over meter. A is 0.13 meter. A is the diameter of the diaphragm. So from that I can calculate AC. So AC is pi A square over 4. Did I miss anything? RA over AC square equals 0.32 meter over meter. So what will I do first when I start trying to analyze this circuit? What did you do in the case of this suspension system for a car?
Waypoints.
Yeah. Whatever are interesting points, you have to figure them out. So the first one could be, we'll just look at the electrical circuit. So on the electrical side, you have LE and RE. Those are the two elements. So there will be a certain threshold above which inductive part of the impedance will become significantly larger compared to the resistive part. So above that threshold, I can only consider inductor in the electrical part. Below that threshold, I can only consider resistor as a very general, a gross approximation. So that, what is the threshold? So that threshold will be when R E equals 2 pi F E L E, right? From here I get my F E equals 1820 hertz. So above 1820 hertz in my circuit analysis, I'll be okay as a first level of approximation if I can drop the resistor. Below that, I'll have to consider the resistor and ignore, I can ignore inductor. Second one is acoustic circuit. Now, of course, if you have software, you can do it. You don't have to do all these things. So for the acoustic part, what should I be doing? This is acoustic. You have a capacitor and a resistance. So I'll do the same thing there. RA equals 1 over 2 pi FA times MA. This gives me FA equals 1 over 2 pi MA RA equals 717 hertz. So I started with the easy part. There are very few elements here, there are very few elements here, I finished those. Now we'll look at the middle one. The middle elements are, what are there in the mechanical? You have a compliance, you have stiffness, that is stiffness, you have mass and you have a dashpot, right? If my transducer is in vacuum, again, abstraction, the role of RA and MA will be zero. right? The mechanical mass, acoustic part, I can ignore that, right? So if my system is in vacuum, they will, the mechanical part will resonate in such a way that is, it has two elements, mass and spring, right? So natural frequency in vacuum is mechanical. In vacuum, basically my F vacuum will be 1 over 2 pi K over M. K is 1 over compliance, so it is MM times CM is 115 hertz. What this physically means is that if I place my speaker in a vacuum and I strike it, it will resonate at 115 hertz. If I place it in free air, it may not resonate at the same thing because there is a radiation impedance. Second one is in infinite baffle. When I place an infinite baffle, I have MM and this MA times AC square in parallel. Right. So I can add these guys and I can find the total, final resonance when this thing is in an infinite baffle. Do you understand it? F infinite baffle is 1 over 2 pi times, has the compliance changed? The compliance has not changed. The mass is changing. Does everyone understand why is AC square here? Because we eliminated the transformer. So this brings down my resonance to 89 hertz. It's a significant difference. The air in the system is acting as a mass and that brings down the resonance from 115 to about 90 hertz. That's a very significant change in frequency. So you cannot ignore the impact role of radiation impedance. Third one, this again, so this is my actual condition. If I place my speaker in a hand or I place it on a table, then it, what frequency it's going to resonate? Natural frequency, will it resonate at F vacuum, F infinite baffle or at some other number? Natural frequency?
Maybe.
Forget the table, I mean I can put it in hand or I can hang it in air. Don't worry about table. See what you have here, okay, bad right. So this membrane is moving back and forth, right? It has two surfaces. One surface is pointing here. Let's say my observer is here. And this is vacuum. This membrane is moving back and forth. It has one surface facing this side, this way. Another surface facing this side, right? So this side, you have the radiation impedance, which we accounted for here by MA times AC square. On this side, there is no radiative impedance because there is vacuum. Now if I place it in hand or I place it on a table, both the surfaces of the same membrane, they will see the same radiation impedance on back side and also on the front side. You understand? So instead of MA times AC square, what will be the new number? The mass, this, it will be twice that in hand. My F is 1 over 2 pi. 1 over CM times MM plus 2M A AC square. So that comes to 75 hertz. So that is, so these are, so what we have identified is, this is something we will care about as we develop the board plot for the whole system. we will also care about this one. We will not care about this one because the actual speaker is mounted in a infinite baffle. We will care about this one, 89 hertz. And again, we will not care about this one because the actual mounting condition is in an infinite baffle. So my board plot will have, it will be something, I don't know what it's going to be like, but it will have several breakpoints, 89 hertz, 717 hertz. This is from acoustic circuit, this is from mechanical circuit, and this is from 1820 hertz, and this is from electrical circuit. And these three, these are the broad terms, these are the three important breakpoints. We are short of time, so we will not develop the actual board plot today. But think about it, that if you want an ideal speaker, loudspeaker, what kind of board plot would you prefer? Should it be flat? Should it be going up? Should it be going down? Should it be wiggly? What kind of a board plot would you like to have? An ideal, perfect loudspeaker.
Flat.
Flat.
Hmm?
Flat.
And why will it be good? What does it mean physically?
Same sound intensity for all frequencies.
Same sound at all. So whatever you are getting in is being faithfully reproduced at equal levels for all frequencies. So bear in mind as we are developing that board plot, and then we'll see the type of response we get for this particular system. Thank you.